Hello friends, welcome to Prostho Hub and it's me Dr. Jolsna. So this is the second session of our smile designing topic. In the previous session, we came across introduction, definition of aesthetic dentistry and smile designing, goal of smile designing, classification of smile. It was mainly three classification by Solomon, by Rubin, as well as Edward Phillips. And the most important section, that's the component of smile, the facial composition. So in this session, we'll be dealing with the dental composition. So before getting into the topic, I request everyone to please do like, share among your friends and subscribe to my channel if you are finding the videos useful. So let us start. So the dental components, also known as the vital elements of smile design, can be classified into two. One is the tooth components and the other one is the soft tissue components. So there are about 9 tooth components and 4 soft tissue components that has to be discussed. So the tooth components are dental midline, incisal length or incisal edge position, the tooth dimensions, zenith points, axial inclination, interdental contact point as well as interdental contact area, the embrasures, SPA, that is sex, personality and age, and symmetry and balance. And under soft tissue components come the gingival health, gingival levels and harmony, interdental embrasures and smile line. Now let us see the first tooth component, that is the dental midline. So what is the dental midline? It is the vertical contact interface between two maxillary centrals. So in our previous session, we have said about interpupillary line. And we said that the interpupillary line should be perpendicular to the facial midline and parallel to the occlusal plane. Similarly, the facial midline and the dental midline should be parallel and the dental midline should be perpendicular to the interpupillary line. So as long as the dental midline is perpendicular to the interpupillary line and parallel to the facial midline, discrepancies up to 2 mm is acceptable. And there are certain anatomical landmarks which help us to evaluate the dental midline. They are midline of the nose, forehead, interpupillary plane, philtrum and chin. And among these, philtrum is the most reliable anatomical landmark. So you can see in this picture, the facial midline and the dental midline is a mismatch. So the line passing through the philtrum as well as the dental midline does not match at all. And also, a midline that does not bisect the papilla is more noticeable than that which does not bisect the philtrum. So in this picture, you can see that the dental midline and the facial midline do not coincide. And in this picture, you can very well see that the dental midline is slanting as well as it is shifted. So this is giving a much more unaesthetic appearance. So, while evaluating the dental midline, one has to consider two factors. One is the location of the midline and the alignment of the midline. Also, maxillary and mandibular midlines do not coincide in 75% of the cases. So, it is always advisable not to keep the mandibular incisor midline as a reference point to set your maxillary midline. And also, this mismatch is not an issue because almost in all cases, mandibular midline or mandibular teeth are not visible during smile. So this mismatch is okay and it is present in 75% of the cases. So in short, midline should be parallel to the long axis of the face or the facial midline. And it should be perpendicular to the incisal plane or the occlusal plane. And it should be over the papilla. That means it should run down the papilla, dividing into equal halves. Now next tooth component is the incisal length or the incisal edge position. This is the most important tooth component as it acts as the reference point for establishing the proper tooth proportion and gingival levels. So the position of the incisal edge influences the labial contour of the incisors, the lingual contour, as well as the anterior guidance. So incisal edge position is the most crucial component. And also there are three important parameters while you set the maxillary incisal edge position. They are degree of tooth display, phonetics and patient input. So let us see them in detail. The first one is a degree of tooth display. So in our previous session, we have said about the lip position, static and dynamic. So in static position of the lip, it is 3.5 mm of the incisal third of the maxillary central incisor that should be visible in a young individual. So as you can see in the picture, around 3.5 mm is visible. So if it is less than 2 mm, then we have to think about procedures like orthodontic extrusion. And also with increase in age, the tooth display decreases. That is because of the decrease in the muscle tone. So this is the degree of tooth display. The next factor is phonetics. So phonetics play a very important role in determining the maxillary incisor length, design and position. And one more point to be noted is that always make the patient sit erect or stand up during the phonetic exercises. This will help you to evaluate better. So there are various sounds that has to be evaluated. The first one, the M sound. So while pronouncing the M sound and patient comes back to the relaxed position of the lip, the incisal display should be the same as that we have discussed in our previous slide. That is 3.5 mm of the maxillary incisor edge should be visible. And so this is the position of the lip once the patient pronounces the M and comes back to the state. The next one is the E sound. That is, during E sound, the incisal edge should be halfway between the upper and the lower lip. The next one are the fricative sound or the F and V sound. So while pronouncing this F sound, the incisal edge should touch the vermilion border of the lower lip. And also the labiolingual position of the maxillary incisors and their length depends upon these fricative sound. So we know that if the maxillary incisor length is too much, then F sound will be heard as V sound. And the final one is the S or the Z sound. So these sounds determine the vertical dimension of speech. So we have already discussed about the pronunciation of the S sound in our full mouth rehabilitation section, that is part 5, about the setting up of your maxillary and mandibular anteriors in detail. So there we have said that in order to pronounce the S sound properly, the maxillary and the mandibular anteriors should come in close approximation and there should be a broad band of air that is essential for the proper pronunciation of the S sound. So there should be a broad band of air. And also during the pronunciation of S sound, the mandibular central incisors are almost positioned 1 mm behind and 1 mm below the maxillary incisal edge. So these are the facts about phonetics. So next one is the patient input. So we have to meet all the demands of the patient as much as possible. The intraoral cosmetic preview and provisional restoration will help us to confirm the proper placement of the final incisal edge position. This will also help us to know about the patient comfort and satisfaction. So these were the three factors: the degree of tooth display, phonetics and patient input. The next tooth component is tooth dimensions. So dental proportion should be related to facial proportion and is very important in creating an aesthetically pleasing smile. So let us see the central incisors. So central incisors create central dominance and they are the key to smile. That means centrals must be the most prominent teeth in the smile and they must display pleasing proportion. That is, the width to length ratio of the central incisor should be 4:5. That means if the width is 0.8 cm, length should be 1 cm. The width should be 75% of the length of the central incisor. So there are certain guidelines for placing this correct proportion and they are the golden proportion by Lombardi, recurring aesthetic dental proportion or the red proportion by Ward, M proportion by Method and choose aesthetic gauges. So let us see them in detail. So the golden proportion in smile design was proposed by Lombardi and according to him, the width of each anterior tooth. So in this picture, you can see starting from the midline, the width of each anterior tooth, that is 60% of the width of the adjacent tooth. So if the width of the central incisor is 1.6, then lateral should be 1 and canine should be 0.6 and so on. So this is the golden proportion that was proposed by Lombardi. But this golden proportion is not that much acceptable because patient will have varying dental arches and facial proportions. If we strictly adhere to this golden proportion, it can result in an anesthetic smile. The next is about red proportion, that is recurring aesthetic dental proportion, that was proposed by Ward. And in this, successive width proportion when viewed from facial aspect should remain constant. That is, starting from the midline, when you go posteriorly, the width proportion should be a constant. That means the width of the lateral by that of central should be same as that of the width of the canine by the width of the lateral. So this red proportion gives us more flexibility in creating an aesthetic smile. So you have to decide a particular width for your central incisor, and then adding that red proportion constant to that will give you the width of the lateral. Again, the same red proportion constant, if you multiply to that lateral incisor, will give you the width of the canine. So this is about recurring aesthetic dental proportion. The next one is the M proportion that was proposed by Method. So in this, the tooth width and facial width are compared using a software. So this is more of a mathematical analysis than an artistic analysis. Next is choose aesthetic gauges. So they are set of innovatively designed color-coded measurement and proportion gauges that is used in aesthetic dentistry. So they help in fast, simple analysis as well as diagnosis of tooth width, tooth length problems, as well as gingival length discrepancies. So as you can see in the picture, they are of three types. This is the proportion gauge, this is the crown lengthening gauge, and this is the sounding gauge. So this is used to, the sounding gauge is used for bone sounding, crown lengthening used during lengthening of crown, and proportion gauge to find out the proportion discrepancies. And the proportion gauge has got a T-shaped end which is color coded, and this color coding predefines desired tooth proportion, so it is quicker and easier to read than any other instrument. So this one acts as a reference guide between the clinician and the lab technician. So there are almost no chances of miscommunication. Now let us see the individual tooth dimensions. So first is the maxillary central incisor. We have already said that they create the central dominance and they are the key to smile. So they are the focal point. The length should be about 10 to 11 millimeter, and the width, as already said, 75 to 80% of length. That is, width to length ratio should be 4:5. And next is the maxillary lateral incisor, which provides individuality. They are never symmetrical and it influences gender characterization. Next is the maxillary canines. They are the critical point in creating a pleasing smile because they are located at the junction of maxillary anteriors and posteriors, and only mesial half of the canine should be visible from the frontal view. And it also supports the frontal muscles. The size and shape of the buccal corridor depends on the canine, and the canine depicts the personality characterization. That means it should be more aggressive and vigorous in males and soft and smooth in females. Now let us see what is buccal corridor. So buccal corridor is defined as a dark space or the negative space that is visible during smile formation, that is located between the corner of the mouth and the buccal surfaces of the maxillary teeth. So as you can see in the picture, so this dark space that is between the corner of the mouth and the buccal surface of the maxillary teeth, this is known as the buccal corridor. So the buccal corridor should be kept as minimum as possible. If there is too much of buccal corridor space, you can fill some of this buccal corridor by contouring the buccal surfaces of the maxillary posteriors. Now, the buccal corridor also gives depth to the smile, but it cannot be completely eliminated. As you can see in this picture, almost it is completely eliminated. It will create an anesthetic appearance. A little bit of buccal corridor is essential in order to give the depth to the smile. The position of the buccal corridor and its appearance is influenced by width of the smile and the maxillary arch, the tone of the facial muscles, positioning of labial surface of the upper premolars, the prominence of the canines, that is particularly at the distal facial line angle. So that was about buccal core. Coming back to the individual tooth dimension, we have to note that centrals should be wider than the laterals by 2 to 3 millimeter, and centrals should be wider than canines by 1 to 1.5 millimeter. The canine should be wider than lateral by 1 to 1.5 millimeter. You can remember the width proportion constant that we already discussed in recurring aesthetic dental proportion. And the canine and centrals are longer bilateral by 1 to 1.5 mm. Next is the maxillary bicuspid. So they also have an important role in arch design because they also help in filling up the buccal corridor space. So we can say that the final aesthetics or final anterior aesthetic is a combination of tooth proportion guidelines, patient's own perception, cultural and social influences, dentist artistic influences, and also an effective communication with the laboratory. So these all factors, once met properly, that will result in an aesthetic smile design. Now the fourth tooth component we are going to discuss is zenith points. So what is zenith point? They are the most apical position of the cervical tooth margin where the gingiva is most scalloped. So as you can see in the picture, so this point, which is the most apical position of the cervical tooth margin. This is the cervical tooth margin, and the most apical position is this arrow point where the gingiva is scalloped. So this point is zenith point. So as you can see, for centrals, it is at the distally to the midline, whereas in laterals, it is centrally located. Again, in the canine also, it is distal to the midline. So it is located slightly distal to the vertical line that is drawn down the center of the tooth, that is long axis of the tooth. Now, what is the importance of these zenith points? So establishing a proper zenith point will help us alter the mesial and the distal dimension of that individual tooth. It helps in closure of diastema. So we have to move the zenith point to provide the illusion of that bodily movement, and it will reduce the exaggerated triangular form between two teeth. And it also helps in correction of tooth angulation. So zenith point is also important in creating an aesthetic smile. So till now we have discussed the four tooth components, that is dental midline, incisal length, tooth dimension and zenith point. The remaining tooth components we'll be discussing in our next. Thank you all for watching my video. Please do like, share among your friends and subscribe to my channel if you're finding these videos useful. If you have any doubt or if you have any suggestion or any topic that has to be discussed, please do message in the comment section or you can write directly to this mail ID. Thank you all once again. We'll see in our next video.